everybody. I'm Mike.
I'm Matt.
We are Armchair Directors.
Strike first.
Strike hard.
No mercy.
This creed on the wall, follow it to the letter. It will make you strong.
It will make you formidable.
It will also make you an asshole.
Taking a look at season two of YouTube Premium's Cobra Kai, the sequel to the revamped Karate Kid show that came out last year and was absolutely amazing and exceeded all expectations. And now they have the difficult task of following it up with another season. Mercy, what'd you think of Cobra Kai season two?
Oh, it was enjoyable. It was some great leftovers. Remember the leftovers analogy I used in the Mary Poppins 2 Electric Boogaloo? Cobra Kai was a gourmet meal. It was perfect, succulent, delicious. It was like a $50 plate, or maybe I'm too cheap, $100 plate. It was amazing, and Cobra Kai is bringing what you couldn't eat home. You doggy bag it, you heat it up the next day in the oven, all right? We're not talking nuke it. You heat it up in the oven, and it's really good. But it is pretty much, it sounds like I'm disappointed. I'm not disappointed because I wasn't expecting anything after Cobra Kai. But it's Karate Kid 2, so here we go. Bring on season 3.
It totally is, and like, I liked it. Yeah. It didn't reach the highs of season 1.
How could it?
And you know what, when I watched season 1, I think I sat down and watched it all. It was like either one night or like almost a day. Yeah. And this, I watched the first two and I was like, okay. And then I sat down and I watched 3 to 6 and I was like, I liked one of those episodes, and I thought the other ones were like okay. And then 7 to 10 were pretty solid, but when season one, every episode ended, I was like, oh my god, I have to see what happens next.
Yeah.
And this one, I was like, well, I guess I'll watch what happens next, but it didn't have the urgency. And part of it is I felt the main stuff I like about this show is how that they did that sort of flip on us with Johnny being sort of like the main guy we follow, and us seeing him and Daniel and their interaction and how their lives went on such different paths. And the most interesting stuff to me was always when Johnny and Daniel have their scenes together, or they are the focal point of like an episode.
Yeah.
And we had the kids and the like next generation people in season one, but I thought like a lot of season two shifted the focus to them, the supporting kids. And we moved away from the very interesting Daniel-Johnny dynamic for a lot of episodes in season two. And it was when we got their scenes together and them struggling separate was where I was really engaged. But it felt like, man, were those guys exhausted from season one that they were like, we're going to be in it. We want to be in it like a quarter the amount that we were last time.
Yeah, it really is. Now that you bring it up, that's the electricity that was missing from season one. Whenever those guys were in scenes together, it was electric, and they just held off this time. I didn't feel like there was less Ralph Macchio and William Zabka. Maybe there literally was, but it definitely less interaction between the two. When they're at the restaurant on the date together, that was just super fun.
Yeah.
And really interesting to, again, see them bond, because they've got this relationship where they're bonding, and smashing heads. And then bonding, smashing heads. They're like brothers, you know. Mm-hmm. They don't realize it, but they love each other like brothers and hate each other like brothers. And then, like, that scene near the end, spoilers, where they fight again. Like, I didn't realize it, but I was just kind of grooving. I was digging the show. It's not bad. When they start fighting, I'm like, oh, yeah. This is like when they fought in season one and there was no clear winner. It was like, knock it off, you idiots. But just when they start throwing around like that, I'm like, yeah. And it's natural when an actor gets older that they're going to try to shoehorn or steer that actor towards, now you're going to play your old mentor character. Remember when you had a mentor? Now you're the mentor. And they're trying to do that in so many movies when they bring back the older, you know, like Mark Hamill and stuff like that. You know, Luke was never meant to be Obi-Wan. I realize that now, you know.
Right.
I thought that was a no-brainer. Well, yeah, he'll be the Obi-Wan character. No, he's not meant to be. Ralph Macchio, Daniel-san, not meant to be a mentor. And it's interesting to see him try to pass on Miyagi's teachings, but it does not work as well. It's not as interesting as when he loses his cool. When he loses right. his cool, again, that's where I go from groove and like, oh, that's so sweet. Yeah, he's doing Miyagi's thing. That's, holy crap, he's losing his cool. It's the old Danielson. I don't even realize I miss it until I see him being an idiot, his old hot-headed self, and flying off the handle.
Right, and what I thought was, in the last season, he wasn't really like the mentor guy until like episode 9 and 10 was the only times right near the end of the season where he sort of fell into that groove. So when he's trying to get Miyagi-Do off the ground in this one, and like a lot of those scenes where he was being like the mentor didn't play as well to me as I kind of hoped that they would.
He doesn't like have a peaceful presence about him.
No, but even like the way that he was teaching these kids and like the stuff they were doing isn't like when Mr. Miyagi would get him to do the chores. And like, even in this, they call him, the kid's like, we aren't here just to do chores. Like,
yeah.
We're not going to do it. And he's like, no, there's more to it. But it didn't feel like he ever got to where like he showed them that there was more to it until like there's one scene, maybe in episode 5 or 6 or something, where he finally does that. But up until that point, I was like, he's kind of leading a rudderless ship for Miyagi-Do. And it just felt meandering. And the fact that it was free, but yet he forgets about the entirety of the rest of his life because yeah. he's just teaching a couple of kids this thing kind of felt like a little bit of a reality disconnect, only because we do know that Daniel, as hot-headed as he can be, and that did explain the moments where he flew off the handle for literally like not a very serious reason. But when he lost sight of his business and his wife, because he was doing this other thing, but he wasn't even doing the other thing so well that we understood, that he could get so caught up in it he would forget about his real life, just felt kind of like they needed some sort of dramatic event to happen. Yeah. And the writers just felt like, we'll just make it this, even if we haven't shown you a reason for it to be believable that Daniel could fall off so bad and not realize that he's losing his most important relationship with his wife as a result.
Yeah.
And they do work in that, you know, it's part of his grief and missing Mr. Miyagi, and that feels relatable, but I just felt like so much of the dynamic that they sold in the first one felt more authentic than it did in this. Part of it is that we spend a lot of time with a very soap opera driven love triangle between Miguel, Robbie, and Samantha, and I didn't really care about it that much. I was just like, I don't love those characters like I do the other ones. And when people are doing dumb things because somebody's mad that somebody made out with somebody else, I'm like, what show is this?
It's really interesting. Miguel and Bobby, right?
That's Robbie.
Name. Robbie. It's really interesting seeing them on, like, whenever I'm kind of getting the Johnny and Daniel vibe when they interact, because you've got Miguel, who has a heart of gold, but he's in a villainous environment. So he's with the villain camp, but he's got a heart of gold. And then you got Robbie, who's with the hero camp, and you'd like to think he has a heart of gold, but he doesn't. He's got a rough upbringing. He's just, maybe he is a good kid, but he's been through so much crap that he's just not going to be smiley and happy and cuddly.
Right.
No matter how, like, and they cast, you know, a very good looking young actor with the long flowing hair and, you know, the pale blue eyes. And he looks like he should be a, you know, like a teen idol type of guy. But the character, as he's written, has been through horrible things and he'll never be happy. I mean, there's people like that in real life. There's just, they've been through too many horrors and they'll never be happy. They'll have their moments, but they'll always have this weight, this dark cloud over them. So it's just interesting to see them play against each other, because it's like, you guys should be the other way around. Why isn't Robbie with his dad in Cobra Kai and Miguel with the guy he should be with, Daniel?
Yeah,
so,
and that,
flipping the script.
That is flipping the script. And I like that dynamic more in the first season than I did in this one, especially because
Miguel,
you know,
was totally directionless this time.
They are drawing those comparisons between Robbie and his dad, but he's being fostered by Daniel. So like, can you work out the Johnny Lawrence out of Johnny Lawrence's son, or is he always going to have that bit of a streak in him?
Yeah.
And some of that's interesting. Now, Johnny was such an interesting and dynamic character in season 1. And in season 2, he gets a few moments, but the introduction of John Kreese, actually having him come back, I was super excited. But the way that they worked him into like the first half of the season, I absolutely hated.
It's the because devil.
He is the devil, but
he's Emperor Palpatine.
Him and Johnny have such a bad relationship that I don't believe Johnny would sort of let him back into Cobra Kai in the capacity that he manages. Yeah. And it takes far too many episodes for Johnny to realize that John Kreese has not changed and he is still up to his same Cobra Kai BS yeah. before he ejects him out of it. And then the main thing we wanted to see happens, I think it's like the last episode where we see that Kreese is training these kids in secret yeah. and says, you know what, Cobra Kai, never die, you can get the hell out of here, this is my dojo now, buddy, I'm taking mine back. And that dynamic of Johnny and Kreese butting heads is more interesting than when, like, I just don't understand how Johnny could have welcomed him back and like let him hang out and teach in the dojo for so many episodes before he realizes this guy's ethos of what Cobra Kai was and what I want it to be do not match up.
And it's the other weird thing is that Kreese was such a cartoon character in the movie. Like, and that the first Cobra Karate Kid movie was so much better than the concept.
Right.
You know, should have allowed
it to
above,
be. Yeah, rose above it.
But the one thing that was still cartoony, that's remained pulpy from the original concept, was Kreese. He was just a mustache-twirling villain idiot. And they've taken so many things from the movie and drawn it out and given it more heart and soul. But Kreese is he's still the devil. Like, there's no complexity to him. There's no, I'm sorry, kid. He could say, like, and they tried, you know, the wars, you know, there's just been too many things wrong with me. But he just, when he stops and he's walking away and Johnny's like, okay, we'll give it another try. And he smiles like, you almost expect him if he had a mustache to twirl it. Like,
right.
He is such a cartoon villain in this really, this thing that's trying to be real and dramatic and soulful. And this guy is just like a psychopath. I guess psychopaths exist in the real world and he's a psychopath.
And that's one of the things that it stands out, I think, because what they did with the first season was they took these characters that we knew what they were about and they flipped the script a little bit. Whereas, you know, Daniel stayed true, but they gave us a new perspective on Johnny and we felt more for him than we have in the past. And with Kreese, they basically just cut and pasted him out of the previous movies and didn't give him any depth whatsoever.
Yeah.
It's just the same character, but everybody else has been updated to be a little bit more human and a little bit more relatable. So when you don't do the same with Kreese, we wonder why other people don't realize immediately this guy does not fit into the world of this show.
Yeah, what would have happened if, I don't know if Johnny would have been the one to go off the rails. Like, what, just, there could have been an opportunity there where Kreese is there and he comes in and there's the big cliffhanger of season one, like, what's going to happen? And then Kreese is like, I taught you wrong. Like, there are no bad students, only bad teachers. And Johnny's like, no, this, you know, what you taught was valuable. And it's Kreese trying to redeem himself. And Kreese could have been the surrogate Miyagi. You know, mm-hmm. like I screwed up, you know, and I've spent the last 20, 30 years making up for my mistakes. So now we've got like, oh, that's really interesting. Like he's trying to atone for his sins. But instead, we've got angry Kreese.
and just again, you know, there's so much time spent with the young cast and some of them like I like more than others. We spend a lot of time with Dimitri, who like I did not care for particularly.
Yeah.
And so like his stuff with him and Hawk, they're back and forth. I wanted to be more invested in that stuff than I was.
He could have been really inspiring. There could have been real chills moments where he gets the karate, you know, wax on, wax off and all that. But instead he's just, he's it's like Cobra Kai is self-depreciating itself through him. Like he makes fun, he demeans things, you know, in a snarky, sarcastic way. And that's not Karate Kid's. Karate Kid is not sarcastic and cynical. It's positive and fearlessly sincere. And then you've got this snarky, cynical kid who, I guess he's warming up a bit, but he's just still such a douche. You know, he's supposed to be one of the good guys, but he's so unlikable. He's just, it makes it hard to feel sorry for him when he's bullied because he is such an unpleasant person. Mm-hmm. Just so negative.
So now I've been harping on a lot of the stuff I didn't like. I will say that this is still got a lot of heart, and those heart moments that come through do make you feel good and do remind you why you liked it. And I thought episode...
How about, before you get into that, how about the old Cobra Kai buddies?
I can see a lot of people loving that. And that for me was like, oh my God, we did not need to see any of these people again. How did this show turn into Wild Hogs for half an hour?
Well, it's...
I hated that. That's going to be my worst part.
One of the positives was like, wow, Johnny has really taken care of himself. Like, despite the hard living, like he looks fantastic. And I just appreciated it because I talked about in the first season review that there's so much reverence shown to anybody. It doesn't even have to be a main character. It can be literally a background character. Well, there's three background characters. And it was just awesome that like these guys got all brought back, and one of them is dying, and he actually imparts a very important message on Johnny. So even though it was a one-off, one and done, well, that's the way to do it with those guys, right? They shouldn't be brought in, you know. Well, maybe it would be interesting to bring him in, like, to run the new Cobra Kai, you know, done right. Or Johnny might bring him in to start his own dojo or something. But I appreciated seeing more old familiar faces, you know, having fun.
And I thought, if it wasn't Elizabeth Shue, then don't bother, because there's nobody else I care about from Karate Kid. So when they brought in them, I was like, wow, we're scraping the bottom of the barrel. They could have got anybody. They could have got anybody and told me it was those four guys, and I wouldn't know the difference based on how they look now. And their acting level had not really improved much since 1984.
I wasn't sure who they were, so I looked them up. And then I realized Bobby, Jimmy, Johnny, Jackie, Robbie, Billy. Like,
because they do us the favor of, they cut to that one scene where they're all riding the motorcycles or whatever, so we know like it's the main four guys. But part of me just thought, like, would they have stayed in touch with the way things went down with them? And there are so many people who don't stay in touch with like people, that it just felt like they were like, we got to get somebody who the people are going to be nostalgic to see. Who's it going to be? And they're like, let's go on this motorcycle adventure. And for me, I was like, take that episode out. I didn't need anything out of it.
I think it works, though, to make Johnny a more sad, pathetic character, that he hasn't created any new real friendships, relationships in the past 20 years, other than these guys he had as friends back then. And I don't think he hangs out with them all that often. I think like, he's probably hasn't seen them for 5 years, right?
And they at least had the right reaction when he said that he was working with John Kreese again, and they were like, the hell,
are you crazy?
Yeah. So like, that was the first time that I was like, okay, well, at least these guys know what's up, and we're taking the blinders off.
How about when he passed away and they're all screaming and yelling and trying to revive him, and I'm sitting there going, he died of cancer. You took him out of the hospital. He knew what he was doing.
Like, yeah, it's not a surprise.
It should have been a more somber moment when he passed, instead of pounding the chest and trying to revive a guy who was on his deathbed and left the bed to jump on a motorcycle.
That part was a little bit weird for me. So you've teed it up. Let's do best part.
Worst part.
I'm going to say best part is still the Johnny and Daniel dynamic. And I love when they butt heads, but I also love those scenes where they're momentarily getting along and they start to realize that they have a lot in common and a lot of shared interests and are really trying to accomplish the same things, just going about it in different ways. And that common ground between these two sworn enemies is some of the more interesting stuff for me.
Yeah. The years have a way of doing that to people.
Yeah, and when we just get those quiet moments, even with them just being sort of self-reflective, are the moments that are the most interesting to me. There were a few of the second generation cast that I cared about, but some of it is just handled so poorly, I don't love it as much. But there is a lot of fun and humor along the way and excitement, and even when it gets soapy, I still enjoyed watching it. If the first season hadn't been like such a surprise, I think I would have liked this one even more, because it's good. It's not a waste of time. I'm glad I watched it, but it's not as good as season one.
Yeah. Isn't it also interesting that, like, if you go back to the Karate Kid movie, all the villains are Johnny, Billy, Jimmy, Jackie, Freddy, you know, and even the girl is Allie. And then on the other side, there's Daniel, not Danny, Daniel. Right. It's interesting. I've never noticed that before.
That is something to consider. And it does very much feel like if Cobra Kai season one was the Karate Kid, this is Karate Kid 2, yeah. Which makes sense. Hopefully they pump the brakes and find a way to make the next season not Karate Kid 3. Worst part for me was that Wild Hogs episode where I just felt like they were scraping the bottom of the barrel for the nostalgia to bring back those guys and put them on a ridiculous road trip when one's on his deathbed. And there were a few moments that I liked of it, but it was one that if I skipped entirely, the season would have felt almost exactly the same for me.
Yeah. Hard to pick a worst part for me because I just enjoyed it from beginning to end. There wasn't really, you know, like that Wild Hogs episode for you. I didn't have an off episode or an off scene or anything like that for me. I appreciated even some of the, you know, like the death scenes. Like, it's nice that they care about the guy at least instead of standing around going, let's get the hell out of here. But worst part, the end battle is amazing and it goes on for a long time. But also in the back of my mind, I'm thinking like, where's the SWAT team? Like, why is this going on so long? It's literally a fight going across the entire school. So I like that they didn't settle on the old formula of another tournament, because that's what I thought, right? Another tournament, and Robbie's going to have his rematch with Miguel, and hopefully he'll win the rematch.
That's season three.
Yeah. So that's exactly what they did in the movies. They brought the tournament back in season three, in the third movie. So the school fight was kind of cool, but it went on a little too long, like Hollywood style, and that's not what this show is. It's not a Hollywood style show. It's Daniel and Johnny fighting and knock it off after a minute where you're just getting warmed up and they have to stop. But that fight went on forever. And then Miguel getting crippled by it. Like, I knew someone had to get hurt bad, but that took the wind out of my sails. Cause like, and I get it. That's more interesting story to tell in season three, his road back from injury. That could be a whole Peaceful Warrior type of story right there, because one of the elements in the movie and the book Peaceful Warrior is Dan Millman shatters his leg, and he's a gymnast, so you know, that can be a very inspiring story, an athlete coming back from a shattered limb, being told you'll never walk again, let alone run or throw kicks. But it's just depressing. So Karate Kid is such an uplifting movie, Cobra Kai was such an uplifting season one, and then it ended with the most depressing cover of Cruel Summer I've ever heard in my life. Cruel Summer.
Yeah, the least joyful version of Cruel Summer ever. And I do think that they ended on that down note where he might be severely injured, and we actually don't know like what his diagnosis sort of is. It's a cliffhanger. Yeah. But also to have that moment where he realizes he's got to offer the mercy because he doesn't want to live up to the no mercy ethos, because he doesn't want to
be
the asshole. It makes it like double a down note, because like he is learning the teachings that are supposed to set the new Cobra Kai apart from the old Cobra Kai. Yeah. And if he had actually just stuck to the old hard Cobra Kai ways, he wouldn't be in this. And so I really hope that they don't take that to make it his road back, but also tip him over the deep end into fully embracing the John Kreese style of Cobra Kai, because he realizes offering mercy was the wrong thing.
Oh, I didn't even think about that. So he might be a Vader now.
Right. You know, like so this might be the inciting incident for him to drop that aspect of himself, right? It depends how the writers decide to take it, but it really did feel like it was a downer to begin with, but because they added that little bit before, it was a double downer.
Yeah, and then conspicuous by her absence, Allie, still not there, and you gotta think they're begging, they're asking, you're an important, you know, they made it clear she is an important part of the puzzle. I can't help but think she's coming back, like the deal is done, because why would you talk about her in such importance? You know, Johnny saying, I never got over her, I never let anyone in like her. She's got to be coming back. But just the final scene again, him throwing the phone away, it could have been the one little bright shining light, and he throws the phone away and she sent him a friend request, which really means nothing. I mean,
right,
getting a friend request doesn't mean anything, but still, it's like it's a ray of hope.
Yeah, and if they do bring her in, they may recast if Elizabeth Shue doesn't want to do it, but also, maybe she has seen like the hype around the show and does want to do it. We'll have to wait and see.
Yeah. I say recast
when and if this comes for season three, if she'll be part of it or not, and how important that will fit in. Because Johnny does mention her a few times, yeah, and they've jettisoned the Johnny relationship that we thought was starting because of how the season ended. So we'll see.
And they've created marital problems with Daniel and his wife. So we could be seeing the love triangle all over again. She shows up. And I say recast her if the actress, if Elizabeth Shue can't do it or doesn't want to do it. And bring in the actress who was in Karate Kid 3 as Daniel's friend. She wasn't really a girlfriend. She was a friend. That's another interesting thing. I remember Ralph Macchio not wanting to do any intimate scenes with that actress because he was married. He got married young and he was like, No, I'm not a Hollywood guy. I'm a real guy and I don't want to make my wife, who's not a Hollywood person, feel uncomfortable that I'm sticking my tongue down someone else's throat, right, even if it is just a movie. So he wouldn't. That's why in part three, he didn't have a girlfriend. He had just a friend who was a girl. And so he's like making out with this actress who's playing his wife now. So I guess something has changed and he's just decided, it's just acting, baby. but bring the actress from part three back and let her play Allie.
Bring her back and have him and her go on a motorcycle trip.
Yeah. But what would also be interesting is if they bring back Hilary Swank. Now, again, I don't know if she'd be interested, but yeah. And you know, we could call it scraping the bottom of the barrel or just, you know, trying to find anybody who has some connection. Any connection will do. If, you know, they have Daniel trying to rebuild Miyagi-Do and maybe Johnny is going to do it with him. I'm going to help you do this. And then they need somebody else to help or they need a financial backer. It would be kind of cool, even though that movie is despised. If Hilary Swank, the next Karate Kid, came in and she's like, yeah, I trained with Mr. Miyagi and I got all of these secret whatever. I've got the missing MacGuffin you guys need.
Yeah.
He gave it to me in that crap fourth movie. It's interesting in that one scene where Daniel says, he's talking about how you can come back from being Cobra Kai to his former Cobra Kai students. And they go, no, that's not true. And he says, I know it's true because I was part of Cobra Kai. And I thought he was lying for a couple minutes. I'm like, oh man, that sucks. He's lying to his students. And then he tells the story of part three and they show the scene in case you forgot. Right. I'm like, I totally blocked that from my memory. Like,
good reason.
Like a traumatic event or something. He was part of Cobra Kai in part three. And yeah. I just love how they worked in a piece of part three in and have him be completely ashamed of it and not wanting to mention it.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like, yeah, that's how you do it. That's how you bring up stuff from the bad movies. Like, I'm not proud of it, but
this happened. I do think we could be going down a road where Johnny and Daniel will team up to take down the new Cobra Kai led by John Kreese, which is basically going to be kind of a remake of Karate Kid 1, right? But we'll see how they take it.
Yeah. Did I do my best part?
Maybe you didn't.
Okay. And best part, those scenes with Johnny and Daniel, whenever they fight, there isn't much intellectualism going on there when they fight, but when they start actually fighting each other, that is Luke versus Vader for me. That's, you know, that's the, Batman versus Joker. It's just, it feels right. And, hopefully they do make peace and get along and, you know, team up against Kreese, and that would be nice, but ultimately what would be even more satisfying is, even though it's a rehash and it's been done, another Johnny Daniel fight. Kind of like Rocky and Creed, we never got to see the rematch. They cut before we got to see the rematch, but something like that. Like, let's go one more time. And like a big tournament maybe, and you know, whether he's justified or not, Johnny feels like he was cheated. And Daniel feels like, hey, you were the one doing all the cheating here. So just a definitive end. Even though the Karate Kid 1 had a definitive end, now there's been some controversy created and it would be cool to just see them go again and have it be definitive where they both shake hands and they go, you win. That's it. No argument. You win.
I think that would be cool. And I hate saying this. I hope next year is kind of like maybe the last year. Unless they find like a real dynamic way to stretch it out. I feel like three is kind of the charm for a lot of these shows. But hopefully whenever they do decide to end it, they know it's the end going into that season so that they can actually write it to be.
And they could go on for a very long time, even without Daniel and Johnny. Like it,
well, and they can with the younger cast, right? They've got unlimited years to keep going if they want.
Yeah.
But let's not run it into the ground, hopefully.
And Kreese will stick around forever. He'll be like, if it went 20 seasons and, you know, he'll be there on season 20. Just... got a great gig.
So that's Cobra Kai season 2. As I might have sounded really down, but like it was a breezy 5 hours and I did like watching it, so it is a good time.
Yeah.
Definitely worth seeing if you watched the first year. Hopefully you've seen it because this was filled with so many spoilers. Hit the comments, let us know what you thought of it.
Yeah, breezy is a good way to describe it. I banged it all out in one day. It flowed all together. It was easy to watch. It didn't have the cliffhanger feeling to it, but it felt like a long movie, like a really good, long, cohesive movie. Didn't feel like, oh, that's a filler episode. Well, not to me anyway. And that's a filler episode. It was really a great pace, nice, deliberate pace. And I'm interested in season 3. So, hopefully it, comes back up. This was just, you know, ramping up for a big finale, hopefully.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot for watching, and until next time.
Enjoy the show.